Buckle up, Dorothy, because Kansas is going bye-bye. No prizes for knowing where that quote came from. This is going to be a long video, and I believe necessarily long, in order to give you as much armament as possible about this method. Once you actually get used to doing things and you've got all the gear together, the time taken to do a deep clean is comparable to other methods. But there are a few choices along the way that you can make concerning things. Now, there are going to be links in the hoo-ha bar. One of those links is going to be to a blog post that I wrote, and in that is going to be some more details of what I'm talking about and links to the various things that I'm talking about. So yeah, the paperwork's sticking to me because it's warm in here, so apologies about my hair, but hey ho. Credit to the authors is the first on my note, and what we're basically going to be going through is this. The precision aqueous cleaning of vinyl records, yeah, by Neil Antin. Now, the actual book in itself is 190 pages, and it's edited by Bill Hart, who has published it for free on the website The Vinyl Press. Link is going to be in the blog post to that. So why does this method differ from many other vinyl cleaning methods that are out there, and why should you be trusting it is probably the wrong phrase, but yeah, what makes this different from all the others that are out there? Right. Central to this is Neil Antin. He doesn't say much about himself in the book. He basically says, "This book is provided as an effort to give back to the communities in which I spent my career and life as an engineer with the US Navy, engaged in precision cleaning techniques, and as an audio enthusiast who has witnessed increasing interest in effective cleaning methods for vinyl records." He doesn't typically go much further than that in there. However, I've got no chemistry background. I suck at chemistry. I mean, honestly, when it came to school, I didn't even attempt O levels. There were two chemistry teachers in my school, and of the two, one was the lead chemistry, head chemistry teacher, whatever. Me and him did not get on. You could say that it was a lack of chemistry. Yeah. But, yeah. Other things were pulling at me. Logic, computers, programming, that sort of thing. So chemistry didn't hold my attention. And I certainly had problems with some things in physics. There was no love lost between the chemistry head and me. I heard that he managed to cause an explosion in the laboratory. And on hearing this, I decided to go up to the staff room, the chemistry lab staff room, knock on the door, and he answered with plasters on his face. I said, "What happened, sir?" He said, "Golfing accident." And that was it. Golfing accident. Yeah, unfortunately, I never learned anything about chemistry, and all the things about molecules and yada yada passed me by. So this is heavy. Well, for someone like me, this is heavy on the chemistry. And I had to post some questions on the Vinyl Engine, I think is where I posted some. Yeah, it was the Vinyl Engine. And within a couple of hours, Neil Antin himself responded. I think he's on the Vinyl Engine forum under Ananda Plume, and when he saw me posting a question about this method, I think he must have registered a new handle in order to in order to answer my questions. Unfortunately, I had many questions, and he was very patient with me for quite a long time, because the kind of questions that I'm asking must be a complete what? You don't understand this, to him. But in terms of the responses, he gave me more information and more guidance, which isn't in the book, purely to bridge the gap. And that's what's included in the blog post. A few other things came from those discussions, including that it looks like he was involved quite a bit in, where did he say? Who is Neil Anton? People can often be cavalier towards some of the risks. My background in precision cleaning of high-pressure oxygen and life support systems has, shall we say, left me very sensitive to safety. Too many years around toxicologists and industrial hygienists. And there's a few more odds and sods in conversation. People were saying thanks for what you've done and all the rest of it. I appreciate the compliments, but I never feel I am above anyone, so please do not put me there. I am in the trenches right with you, learning as we collaborate. If you disagree with my recommendations, that's fine. I have no ego to stroke. The long story short about Neil is that he seems to have considerable knowledge in chemistry, and he says as a chemistry engineer. I think in another section he said that he brings various things together to produce a solution with repeatable results. He said he can't mix chemicals better than some of the companies like Alkanox, which we'll come to, but he knows his stuff. And the system works, basically, is the long story short. So yeah, he's not your average, you know, he's experienced in chemistry, high-end chemistry and all the rest of that jazz by the looks of it. And yeah, he's got reason for saying what he's saying. A chunk of what he's saying just went straight over my head, but hey ho. So the blog post and this video are in no means meant to be a replacement for the book. The book contains a considerable amount of information, 190 pages, some good illustrations and pictures, and yeah, Neil actually sort of put forward that, you know, only 35 pages of that book are actually needed in order to understand the method. Well, I think it's worthwhile reading the whole thing, because he also goes into other sections. And indeed, one of the other things that he said was that he's also bringing in things from other people who have been involved with this. You know, people have done trials and various bits and pieces. To go to the extreme, he said, I don't have the patience, I'm paraphrasing here, I don't have the patience to spend 24 hours waiting for wood glue to dry on a record, to peel it off, then wait another 24 hours for the other side, and then blow ionized particles over the record, because it'll be charged as hell. You know, other people have helped him out on those things and brought results back to the table, and he's put those on board. So there's quite a few people who have been doing some bits and pieces on this. Yeah, so it's not all Neil, and Neil seems to, you know, he doesn't have an ego to stroke. He's more than willing to help out, as was proven with the amount of help that he gave me on Vinyl Engine. he did, obviously, run out of some time. at one point during the conversation, he basically said, look, I'm not retired anymore. I don't have endless amounts of time to give. And fortunately for me, that was at a point where we'd reached in understanding where I'd reached my limit, because we were talking about something called myceles or mycels or something. And yeah, so that's who Neil is, and that's why this system works, basically, because it's not, it's built based on somebody's knowledge who's been in this industry, in the chemical industry, for a considerable amount of time. So why do some of this stuff? What have I got here? I'm going back to the basics in here because I know that there are some young people who are following, and yeah, that's all I can say on that one. One of the other things that I wanted to mention was dementia. There's going to be a link in the hoo-ha bar, and music is quite a powerful window to memory. I've helped a few people out by digitizing small portions of their vinyl collections and putting them on CD so that it's easier to, for them to be, for their music to be played. And that's one of the reasons why I found it important to go through this. I've been trying this for a number of years, and this has blown my previous cleaning out the window. And indeed, if you try and find the video of my cleaning method 5 years ago, you'll find that it's not there anymore. Because one of the things that Neil did say, I was using horticultural soap, and Neil said, if you read the container label, it's 15% potassium oleate, which is a potassium salt of oleic acid, and it is alkaline, high pH of 10.5 to 11, neutral pH is 7. Its general use is as an emulsifier, same as non-ionic surfactants. And has some wetting ability similar to non-ionic surfactants. However, the in-use concentration appears to be much higher. The alkalinity of the product can help with the saponification of animal and vegetable fats to form soap. It does not have the cleaning performance of Liquinox, we'll come onto that, which is a neutral pH, and it does not have the wetting or emulsifying performance of the exfoliated alcohol non-ionic surfactants such as Defeon or Turgotol, we'll come onto those, and potassium oleate, when it dries, will dry to a salt-like consistency. You definitely do not want this dry on your records. Made sense to him. The only thing that counted for me was I know enough to know pH, acid, alkaline, and when he said high pH, you don't want it dry on your records. I thought that's enough for me, so I've deleted the previous videos. Yeah. And this is the trick. There is an awful lot of language like this with various chemical names and all the rest of it, which part of this video is to open the door to some of those for you and to demystify some of the language like that was. So on reading that, on reading what he had to say about it, I've basically deleted the other cleaning posts. Yeah. So where are we? So there are reasons for bringing for bringing music back and cleaning old vinyl collections. So if you know, dementia is going to strike more than 1 in 20 of us. There are promising Alzheimer's drugs and a few other bits which are opening the door, but there is no cure for dementia or Alzheimer's. You know, the best they can do is slow it down. And if you, if you manage to get music, someone's vinyl collection, as the older generation will still have, I'm trying to pick my words very carefully. if you do need to try and reach them, if they do start going into their own world and you need to try and reach them, their vinyl collection will give you, should open a door into music, which will hopefully bring them a little bit closer to you, shall we say. So that's something. But the problem is, a lot of this stuff was never digitized. And Neil, as you see, he's been very generous with the time, very patient towards me. And that's those notes expired. Now I'm winging it as usual. So we shall go through more or less the blog post. Now, one of the obviously, I'm going to present this, but what I'm basically presenting is someone else's work and other people's work as well. And I just want it understood that I'm not presenting to you my work. I'm presenting his and other people's as well. So I'm in no way taking credit for any of this. And even though I'm not going to, if I tried to give all the credit for everything that was due, then this video would be like 7 times as long. But I've done what I can, and we'll see where it goes. The basic premise of this, the aim, is to end up with a final record which is as clean as possible, within reason. Neil pretty much says that, has he got a quote in here? There are various quotes, and I've got bits and pieces, but the long story short about this is, once you've done or worked out the best that you can, then whatever remains is probably going to be inherent to the vinyl itself. So obviously the intention is to get it as clean as possible. There are going to be other links in the hoo-ha bar and other links in the blog post itself, but vinyl records are made up of a mix of things. This is one thing. Can I read it from the back? There's all sorts of chemicals that make it, that put it in there. Plasticizers, lubricants, fillers. Some of the chemicals are actually in there to help the pressing process itself. And basically, there's no coatings put on a vinyl record after it's pressed for you, or that there shouldn't be. So the aim is to get it, as many chemicals and other stuff off it as possible, so that all you're left with is the vinyl as it was when it was pressed, less, of course, any physical damage. So that is the aim of this process, to get it chemically clean. There are all sorts of things that can be on vinyl. Typically, in the modern household, in the modern playing environment, dust and static electricity are your main enemies. Vinyl from the 60s, 70s, 80s, some of the stuff I'm repeating from stuff I've said in other videos or blog posts, whatever. I class that as old vinyl, because vinyl was the primary method by which music was bought, sold and enjoyed in households. And my memories are of more social times, when records were put on, when we had family gatherings and that sort of thing, and people smoked then and indoors. Secondhand smoke wasn't really too much on people's radars, and all sorts of things were happening. Records weren't handled as well, you know. They were consumer items back then, so you know, record players weren't as finely tuned as they are now. So records of the 60s, 70s, 80s, you know, they've got a fair bit of damage to them. What you get is luck of the draw, and it's not straightforward to bring them back. There are three primary methods in my book of cleaning records at the moment. Manual, which is pretty much what we're going to go through at the moment. It is obviously manual, it's hands-on, it takes time, but you're not reliant on a machine that can go wrong. You've also got a bit more freedom in terms of the chemicals that you're using, so there's that to be said, and I think it's possibly the cheapest of the options. The other one is sort of vacuum cleaning machines. They go for between £500 to £2,500. Fair chunk of money. They are principally still manual cleaning. You're still putting liquid on and working it through the grooves and the rest of it, but there's a vacuum to suck it all off. I think one of the things that Neil said was in amongst some tests that were run, it only took like 35%. 35, 30, blower style vacuum RCMs do not suck up all fluid. 15 to 30% is evaporated in place. I worked with someone in the UK, and this last winter, where that was verified using a high performance UV dye. Dye was added to Liquinox and Citronox, and the amount dried in place, yada yada yada. So I won't be following the process. I won't be buying one of those machines. Because basically I've got the manual process, I'm happy with it, so why spend money on a machine which is basically manual anyway? And indeed, there was one other warning that Neil states in the book, and indeed, blah 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 blah, no, he didn't actually state it in the book, he said it somewhere else. Do not use Citronox with a vacuum pump style RCM like the monks. It will eat the pump. Citronox being an acid. There does seem to be one place where Neil would recommend those vacuum machines over a manual process. And that's because this manual process does rely in some instances on flowing tap water, if you've got good quality tap water. If you don't have good quality tap water, you end up having to use distilled water, and you could end up going through a crap load of it. So that's when a vacuum-based cleaning machine could come into play, if you don't have good quality tap water, because that machine would then use less water in the process. What you would do in terms of which chemicals you'd use and not use, I'm not sure. Then you have ultrasonic. Ultrasonics for cleaning anything has been around since before me, and there was a patent for using ultrasonics to clean vinyl records that was made before I was born. It's just in recent decades ultrasonic machines have come into play that are more consumer friendly, shall we say. They vary in price again from about £300 to £500 for a modified jewellery ultrasonic bath, up to about £2,500 for the degritter Mark II. And I don't believe it's an either or situation. The manual process will get rid of oils, greases, that sort of thing, which the ultrasonics are not very good at getting rid of. And I've been watching some videos from second-hand vinyl merchants, and they've been going through their cleaning and why they do what they do. And pretty much, yeah, so even though I've got the manual process working well, I will still get myself an ultrasonic cleaner of some description in the future, in order to hopefully take it a bit further, even though it's going to cost a small chunk. Now, I've managed to get this process to the point where I can take a record out of the sleeve, put it straight on the deck and play it. I don't need to use any brushes, and that's impressive. That is very impressive in my book. Obviously there are clicks and stuff, but the question is, if there are going to be clicks and stuff in that record, in those records, then why clean them anyway? And that is because there's more to play for in cleaning a record than just the clicks and scratches and dirt. And that's known as sibilance. It's when you hear like, I've got these ready, because these are some of my father's old records, which have basically been given a new lease of life by cleaning. And you can pretty much see what he was into. He did have a very wide range of music, but we're talking brass there, trumpets, more brass, military bands, you know, and other big bands. And when you're talking trumpets, you're talking high clarinets, singers with the S sound. Those will be muddy on a record, and it will not be enjoyable to listen to. If you clean the record, you should be able to get rid of a fair chunk of sibilance, and then the music will be more enjoyable to listen to. And at that point, you know, some of the crackles and you know, fade, they're there, but they fade into the background more, because the music itself is sharper and better defined. And that's one of the other main reasons for actually cleaning the records. It's not just to try and get rid of some of the clicks and pops, it's to get a better sound overall out of the record. Even if you're then going to digitize it, even if all you're going to do is digitize it, it's very worthwhile going through a manual clean. Because a good manual clean will get a better signal, and that signal is your source. With whatever you do about it afterwards, that's your source. And going to the extent of doing one of these cleans, I think it's pretty important to do it. So there are there's a lot of reasons for doing this. Where am I? So you've got to understand the enemy. Static, dust, get rid of that stuff. When to deep clean a record, or how clean is clean enough, and that only you can decide that. I mean, Neil did take issue with me over that. He says what is clean, and for a record, the next question should be, when is a vinyl record clean? Chapter 1, Vinyl Record Cleaning Challenges. Indicated, we have no practical quantitative verification method. This chapter attempts to answer these questions by establishing quantitative criteria and to show that the process detailed can achieve a clean vinyl record. And indeed, he's right. It's just if you're in my kind of situation where you don't have high-powered microscopes or anything, you're just left with your eyes, your ears, and maybe a 10 times magnification scope. You can't investigate the quantitative criteria. So hey-ho. Ultimately, it's down to your decision as to how far you go in cleaning your records. When to deep clean a record is another question. Personally, every record now that comes in the home, whether brand new or second hand, is going to get a deep clean, a manual deep clean, to get off, because you don't know what's on it. Even new records have been coming in, and I've got a picture on the blog post of Guardians of the Galaxy 3, brand new, straight out of the sleeve, and the crud that was on it was just a brand new record. You're not taking that straight out and putting it on the turntable. No way. No way, Jose. Not good at all. So, yeah. Everything is going to get a deep clean, and I think the rest of it is going to determine what ultrasonics do. I mean, principally, if I believe at this point that if I exercise good hygiene in handling the records and the rest of it, then hopefully, if I start to hear pops and clicks, then I should just be able to give it a five minute cycle in an ultrasonic cleaner before putting it away again. So I think that the manual cleaning process hopefully may not be used that much, because the ultrasonics is good against particles, not so good against oils. And as long as I'm careful with my handling, and there's no I don't smoke anymore. The old joke is, I don't smoke any less either. Boom, boom. Then there should be nothing really in terms of oils that should really get on the surface of the records anymore, I hope. So we'll see what happens. But everything when it comes in now is going to get deep cleaned, brand new or second hand, I don't care. But you've got to make your own decisions. And indeed, I'm not sure whether you can see this, but this is actually the picture from the blog post of the new copy of Guardians of the Galaxy 3 and all the crap that was on the record when it came out. So, also in the blog post is a link to a post which was on Audio Science Review, where somebody does actually post some microscope pictures before and after using this cleaning method. So, what is this cleaning method? Basically, it involves four chemical washes, well, three chemical washes, possibly two chemical washes, depending. And, yeah. I've got a video at the end of this of me doing a manual clean on a record, so you can see what it looks like. Because in times, you know, simply trying to sit here and explain it to you is not really going to be good enough. Yeah. So we'll go through some of the equipment and talk through some of it. The first thing that you're going to need are some spray bottles, four of them. These are typically about 360 or 400 mil bottles, roughly. Neil did suggest some bottles with HDPA plastic. HDPA plastic, if you heard that term before, it's also the term for some of the record sleeves, the inner sleeves that have been bought. There's a link to some. You need four of them. There's a link into a pack of three. So two packs of three, give you four bottles and a couple spare, because I don't know about you, but pretty much the sprays always cop out on me. So that may be worth looking at. And so you're going to need some spray bottles. The other thing you're going to need is a record label protector, and that's another one. Initially, I went for this type. As you can see, it's clear, and you can probably see in there is a rubber washer. Well, in fact, there's two rubber washers in there. This came with two of these, rather than the long one that I'm unscrewing now. And it comes apart like that. And as you can see, this is always a pain in the ass, because you're also fighting to keep these in the grooves when you're trying to put them on. And then, it is a problem trying to assemble the damn thing. Not only that, when you take it apart after a clean, first off, it can be very difficult to get apart, which is why you possibly need a plastic plectrum to just break the seal. Just nip in there and break the seal so you can take it off. The second is that the edges of this, if you drop it, you're going to scratch the record. You stand quite a risk of scratching the record there. So that was my first attempt, and no. So that's that. I'll put that together later. Stuff it. And then I ended up with this. Now, I did put a link in the blog post to this, and this actually came with two of these handles, which are much better to grip with, but I replaced one with one of the knobs, and just to make it a bit narrower that way for turning in the sink. Now, these are a different proposition. It wasn't easy to see in the photographs, but as you can see, there's rubber all the way around the outside. And it's effectively double-sided to a degree, so it doesn't matter which. And if you pick it up and accidentally drop it, the rubber stands less chance of damaging the record. So that, in my view, was a lot better. And I think because of the construction, I haven't had this jam on the record. I haven't had it stick on the record. They've come off when I've pulled them off. Hasn't given me any trouble. These come in two sizes, one for 12 inch, one for 7 inch, and I checked the link on Amazon to find that they're unavailable. But being Chinese, you'll probably find them again under some brand name, I don't know. But this is the version. It just looked white on Amazon, on the pictures, and there wasn't much in terms of detail, so I was a bit skeptical, but I'm glad I got these. Very glad I got that. I got a price list here as well. All the prices of these are in a table in the blog post. The spray bottles, 26 for two lots of three. The label protector was £25. Pipettes. You're going to need something for getting the chemicals from the bottles from the bottles they come in and into those, and that's where pipettes come in. Oh, also, for filling other bottles, you probably want to get a small funnel as well. Add that onto your shopping list. These are 100 5 milliliter pipettes. Why so many? It comes into the longevity of the chemicals, and I'll come into that in a bit. But yeah, give me a few years and I'll probably go through all of these. Probably go through all of those. Then you're going to need a brush. Now, this is the one shown is Lorry Craft. These brushes are typically marketed from the size of the record that they were clean. This is a 12 inch brush. It's not actually a 12 inch brush, it's a brush meant to clean a 12 inch record. Now, the bristles are reasonably tough here. They're not totally outlandish, but they're reasonable. And I wouldn't use something like the goat's hair. The goat's hair are too soft. These are reasonable. What the fundamental that you're doing with the chemicals is you're agitating the chemicals so that the chemicals do the hard work. The actual depth of the grooves is not that big. It's not that deep. You're not. It wouldn't take an awful lot of effort to push something into the groove. But this is all about getting up, agitating the chemicals to get them working. Now, this I bought in 2016 for about £25. This is a Russ Andrews brush. Now they're going for about £50. Eek! The Keith's Monks versions are like £60. But there is a Loricraft, which looks to me to effectively be the same brush, for £20, a little under £20. there is also another one, which is Record Doctor, and that, if you factor in a bit of postage, you can get that one for about £35. But for me, this brush, if the Loricraft brush is this brush, you should be quids in with this, and you will only need the one, or you should only need the one. So that gets you pretty much the setup. That gives you pretty much all that you need in order to start the cleaning process. There are a few other bits and pieces that come after, but you've now got your bottles, you've got your label protector, and you've got the stuff to put the chemicals in the bottles. Chemicals. This is where things get very interesting. Now, later on, the whole thing apparently is around surfactants. One of the links in the blog post will be to a video on surface tension, or actually it's pond skaters and how pond skaters use surface tension of water in order to move at quite high speed. But surface tension is what stops water from getting in to the grooves to do any cleaning. You've got to break the surface tension. To do that, you need a surfactant. That chemical breaks down the surface tension and the water can get in. But it's not that simple. There are three different types of surfactant, I think. It got into a conversation of my seals, and that's where I got lost. But chemically, you add a surfactant to the water, and that breaks down the surface tension aspect. But when you add more, it actually forms something called micelles. I still don't understand them, but what the micelle does is it's then got a head and a tail. The head is responsible for the surfactant side. The tail is what then picks up the dirt, the grime, and there are various different types of surfactant which will target different types of dirt. And the first chemical is thus this one, Liquinox. You've probably heard me mention that name, by a company called Alkanox. And it's not the easiest to get hold of. In fact, it's also the most difficult to find a replacement for. Neil states, the product is a combination of anionic surfactants, good for general detergency, non-ionic surfactants, good for oil emulsion and wetting, and foaming agent to lift and float debris from the surface. That's roughly what it's doing. And surprisingly little of this is needed. It is a ratio of 1 to 100. So in this 400ml bottle, I would just need 4 milliliters of this. A tiny amount. It stunned me that so little chemical was actually needed. Absolutely stunned me to pieces. I 4 mil? You sure? That little? But yeah, that little is what's needed. So potentially a bottle like this could last you a long time. The elastic bands were where I was actually keeping a pipette before I actually was told that, yeah, pipettes have life issues, but that's a long story short. There are preparation instructions in the book for each of the 4 different bottles. And they are labelled as such. Number 1 is the pre-clean. There can be a number of different combinations of this. This is what Neil has said is doing the majority of the work. So this is the pre-clean. This is the important one. If a record is very dirty or dirty, whatever, he will also give it an acid wash. And that's another one. If it's very dirty, then he will get rid of, he will give it 2 of the pre-clean and 1 of the acid wash. He will then go onto a non-ionic detergent, NID for short, non-ionic detergent. We'll come onto that as well. And then finally, distilled water. All that this bottle contains is distilled water. That's it. So, for a brand new record coming into the home, pretty much I wouldn't use the acid wash. It would just be a pre-clean, then this one, the NID clean, and then the distilled water. So that's roughly what's going on. So the first chemical is doing the majority of the hard work. Liquinox itself has proven to be very hard to get hold of. It has, the seller that I contacted, you know, if you look it up, it only costs about £20 to £25 for what the Americans call a quart. And a quart is just shy of a litre. So, you know, all bar the arguing, it's a litre, what the hell. And when various other things like postage and the rest of it came in, it was looking at like £60. Well, probably £60 plus at the end of the day when that came in. So if you can get it, good on you. If you can't, there are some alternatives. One of the alternatives ended up being something called vinyl clear. Now, vinyl clear was previously available. I know I've got some maths around here somewhere. Vinyl clear was available in concentrated form. It isn't anymore. They're doing it in premix. However, the premix is coming in very expensive. If you take £60 for Liquinox, at 1 to 100, 1 litre of this will make 100 litres of a cleaning solution. And let's say it does you about 5,000 records. That's going to come in at 1.2 pence per record. If you use vinyl clear, which at the moment is coming in at £22 for 500 millilitres, you're basically looking at 88 pence per record to clean 5,000 records. Well, if you were bought enough to clean 5,000 records, yeah, that's roughly what it would come in at, 88 pence per record. So 1.2 pence per record against 88 pence per record. I don't think I'll be buying vinyl clear. Yeah. And there is a last, which is the eCover Zero Non-Bio Laundry Liquid. You can get it in most supermarkets, and it costs £10 for a bottle. Well, £8 for a bottle, and possibly a bit more for... What was that the price that I've got? I've started mixing some of this up now, which is a bit of an arse. That'll serve me right. I will go through all this again, so don't worry about it. It's to give you a bit of pipettes, £8. Loricroft brush, £20. E-cover, non-bio laundry liquid, 1.5 litres, £10. And if you decide to go for the laundry liquid, there is more instruction in the blog post on how to mix it. So, there's another aspect to this, which is the life of the chemicals. If you actually go, you're actually using so little of this, there's a question as to how many records you're going to clean. What is the lifespan of this? Well, I contacted Alconox, who were very helpful, and they said basically 2 years, and if pushed, they can certify for 3 years. But that's where Neil basically said, look, they can only quote what they've got to quote in terms of certification for professional use. We're not using it for that. Shelf life, basically, I have the notes on shelf life. Concentrate is safe for long-term storage in a sealed container in a cool 60 Fahrenheit to 16 centigrade to 80 Fahrenheit to 27 Celsius room temperature, dry, dark location. Note that most manufacturers will generally indicate the chemicals are good for about 2 years shelf life. There are too many variables for them to commit to any durations any longer, but properly stored, they can last much longer. The concentrated NID, Liquinox and Citronox should last many years, well beyond three. Whatever small minor change in effectiveness that may occur is inconsequential for cleaning records, but for certified food or laboratory processes, where shelf life is a quality assurance attribute, adherence to shelf life becomes an auditable item. But for record cleaning, only if the chemicals become cloudy or if they take on a foul, obnoxious odour should you have any reason to dispose of them. As far as when mixed for use, if you prepare in a spray bottle that mostly isolate the content from the air and bacteria, you should get 6 to 8 weeks at least. Where you can get into trouble is if you leave the concentrated cleaners open to the air at warmer temperatures for extended periods, and if you reuse an eyedropper or pipette. Just open long enough to extract the amount needed with a fresh pipette and then seal and store in a dark, cool place. Under a sink is fine. So one of the variables on this is how long they last themselves, and generally, as Neil has indicated, if you keep it, only open it when you need to open it, and use a fresh pipette every time so you're not contaminating it, and keep it in reasonable temperatures, there's no reason why it shouldn't last about 6 years. And that is arbitrary, because nobody can be precise, and the key thing is to notice when it discolours or starts to go smelly. That's when you need to get rid of it. So this should last about 5,000 cleans over 6 years if I take care of it, and the same for the others. That becomes a reasonable proposition for me when faced with the cost of vinyl clear. Let's start this again. Liquinox, yeah, it's going to cost £60 to £70 in order to get it in 1 litre form. More on that in a bit. It'll last about 6 years if I take care of it, and it'll clean about 5,000 records, probably a bit more. So that's the kind of value proposition I'm looking at for there. Vinyl clear, the expense of it is just a bit bonkers for me. E-cover zero non-bio laundry liquid is probably what I would go for if I could not get hold of Liquinox. There is a problem, not a problem, an issue that you need to be aware of with the non-bio laundry liquid, in that Neil says that they artificially thicken it for the consumer so that it's a look and feel thing. So if you do use that, you're probably going to have to take a bit longer on your wash. And that's pretty much your first chemical. Your first chemical is the heaviest chemical of the lot and probably the most complicated to handle in terms of buying it and working out what you're going to do. I will run through all this again. The trick is to get your head around some of the questions with the limitations and bonuses of each of these. That's the pre-clean. Number two is your acid wash. Now the acid wash is when another chemical comes in, again from Alkanox, but it's called Citronox. And as the name Citronox might suggest, citrus acid. That's what this is doing, and hence it's called the acid wash. Now Citronox, as you can guess, as the issues with Liquinox come in, trying to get hold of Citronox is an arse. I think I've got some coming via a friend who had to buy it for me because he owns a business. The company that I was trying to buy this stuff from would not sell to me because I'm an individual. I had to be a business. But there's something else that's now blown Citronox out of the water for me. They have stopped selling Citronox in quarts. It's available in gallons only. In theory, that would be enough for 20,000 records, plus a bit. Am I going to clean 20,000 records in 6 years? I don't think so. And a gallon of that stuff would cost more than £100 to get hold of. Not very good. Fortunately, there is a much better alternative, well, a much easier alternative. It's not as good as Citronox, but it does the job perfectly well, according to Neil, and he should know, and it's easier to get hold of. And it's this. White vinegar, 5% diluted. Now, whether you need to get as much of it as this, I don't know. I went a bit overboard. You can buy diluted 5% white vinegar in most supermarkets. It just depends how much and in what quantities. What did Neil say on this? The alternative is common grocery store distilled white vinegar, labelled 5% acidity. Do not use flavoured vinegar or red wine vinegar, just the cheap stuff. Distilled white vinegar, labelled 5% acidity. Avoid any with acidity higher than 5% instead of distilled water. Right. So I'll go into the mixing in a bit. But the problem is how much is you going to are you going to use? I think I've used two of these. I think I've used a litre of acid wash doing about 50 or 60 secondhand records. Well, old vinyl, not necessarily secondhand, old vinyl. If you're not doing that many, a litre of distilled white diluted white vinegar, 5% acidity from the supermarket should do you fine. If you're going to be doing anything more than that, 5 litre is probably where you want to. If you're thinking you're going to end up with multiples of buying 1 litre from the supermarket, then you might want to consider 5 litres of white vinegar. White vinegar also has other uses around the house as a cleaning agent. Glass, other things like that. If you can stand the smell when you're actually cleaning glass and all the rest of it, why not? We use various things like we use a number of different cleaners around the house that we buy in squeezy bottles and all the rest of that jazz. And if you can replace some of those with white vinegar, you might save yourself a bit of money. So it's worth looking up using white vinegar around the house and thinking how many vinyl records you're going to clean with the acid wash, and work out how much white vinegar you want to use. So the Citronox has basically knocked itself out of the race by being not available in the smaller sizes, not available in a quart anymore, and being quite expensive and difficult to get hold of. And as Neil said, because of the effectiveness of the white vinegar, you might as well go for the white vinegar. Third chemical, your non-ionic detergent. This got to be a bit of a mess. Right, non-ionic detergent. There is something that Neil was sort of against me bringing up, but I'm going to bring it up for you. In the US, they will use something called Turgotol, and it's various mixtures. If you're in America, Neil says Turgotol 15S9. Now, you will see a discussion about mixing 15S3 with 15S9. 15S3 being better at being better as a degreaser, whereas 15S9 is better as a surfactant. Neil cautioned me against mentioning 15S3, but you will see it in discussions, because the library, the US library of whatever the heck they call it, I've forgotten where it is, but one of the US archival libraries were doing just that, mixing 15S9 with 15S3 to get a mixture of the grease removal plus the surfactant. And eventually they settled on Turgotol 15S7 rather than mix the two themselves, which is a bit of an arse. If you know about chemistry, trying to mix chemicals ain't easy. And they settled on 15S7. Neil recommends 15S9. But we can't get it in the UK. I think it's because it contains a chemical called Triton X100. And I think that is one of the components of Turgotol, if I understand my facts correctly, and I could very easily be wrong. And because of that, Triton X100 is banned in the EU and the UK. I'm not sure whether it's also banned in Australia as well. But fortunately, there are a number of alternatives. One is Daifun, which is made by BASF, many people will know from the days of tapes. There is also another alternative, which is Ilfatol. Now, I knew Ilfatol from my days in the darkroom, It's surfactant, but I got my wires crossed. And that's because I did not understand how a surfactant actually works. And that comes basically to what I was talking about before. Where do we have it here? Notes on BAK50. It's on the website, but not here. Long story short is, as I was saying, it's all to do with these micelles. And after you've put too much, a certain degree of surfactant in, it stops doing a surfactant thing and it starts generating micelles, which are the bits that actually are responsible for attaching themselves to the dirt and taking it away. And there are various types that do various things. Like I was saying about the pre-wash, there are different different ionics, whatever the heck they call them, in there. That is why there are three alternatives listed: BASF, ilfadilfatol, and polysorbate 20. They're all listed as substitutes for Turgotol 15S9. This can be got from Conservation Resources. There's a link in it. The others can be got from Amazon. Where I got myself messed up is because Defoon is listed as Defoon? 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 D-E-H-Y Dapon. Dapon, I think. I think I'll call it Dapon. What the heck? These chemicals are driving me nuts. Is because it was listed as a detergent as opposed to being listed as a surfactant. Yeah. Safety data sheet for Dapon LS54. Yeah. That's where I got messed up, because Dapon was listed as a detergent and Ilfatol was listed as a surfactant. Actually, they're pretty much doing sort of the same thing. So that's how I ended up with both of them. I ended up with Dapon and Ilfatol. So yeah, wasted a bit of money there. And that is basically how it, what it comes down to. There are links. There's a link to Conservation Resources for the Dapon. Ilfatol you can get off Amazon. I don't know enough about chemistry to know if one is better than the other, but I've been using the Dapon and I'm happy with it. And again, the same things apply in terms of size, usage, shelf life, all the rest of that stuff. The fourth is simply distilled water. The job of the fourth one is to displace the tap water, because basically what you're using is you're using tap water between the washes in order to help get the previous chemical off the record. But the tap water itself is not distilled. The key, there are going to be links in the blog post as to the difference between distilled water and deionized stroke demineralized water. The long story short is that tap water carries stuff in it. If you've ever got a glass of water and actually taken a couple of spoons of sugar and then mixed it in, you can't see the sugar anymore. It's gone into suspension. The sugar is in there. If you taste the water, you will taste the sugar, but you can't see it. And if once the water evaporates, if you were to let it all evaporate away, what would happen is the sugar crystals would be left behind. And that's the problem with using tap water. Indeed, with many other chemicals. As Neil says, it's not really what the chemicals do, it's what they leave behind after, which is the problem. And as stated at the start, the goal here is to try and... My God, I've been yakking for an hour already. hour and nine, is this? Jeepers. You can tell how this is getting complicated. It's what they leave behind that's the problem, and that's the problem with tap water. There's all sorts of stuff which is in suspension. So if you leave tap water on a record, when it evaporates away, you'll be left with whatever the water was carrying. That's why you use distilled water, because there's nothing in it. Now, it's worthwhile buying this in 5 litres, because you will go through it. If you've got distilled water hanging around, which is more than a few years old, you'll probably want to get some fresh, because pretty much you'll use a fair chunk of it. Not only in the last one itself, but also in the other mixes, because that is what's causing the major that's what the major ingredient of these is. This, the pre-clean, is mostly distilled water with a few, you know, it's like 400 milliliters of distilled water with 4 milliliters of whatever it was, Liquinox in it, distilled water. And if we were using Citronox, then the acid wash would also be distilled water with a few mil of Citronox in it. That's also what the NID cleaner is, distilled water with a very tiny amount of Dapon in it. So you will use distilled water quite a bit in all these mixes. In our case, the one exception, because we're using vinegar, is this is mostly vinegar. This is mostly all the 5% vinegar mix, with just the tiniest drop of Dapon in it. The mixes are actually on the blog post. So that's what's going on here. It's mostly distilled water is driving this. The tap water is pre-washed. So once you've done everything, you use distilled water to knock off the tap water, because you don't want tap water left behind. That is the point of that. So there's a few other bits and pieces regarding safety. And that is, if you happen to have any of these COVID masks hanging around, my advice is wear them. Wear one of them. Also, if you're not wearing glasses, get some eye protection. And also some nitrite gloves. £5 for a pack of 100. Why? Well, first off, the gloves are a no-brainer. You are spraying acid and other chemicals onto the record, and they're all going to come off onto your hands. So you do not want some of this on your hands, particularly when it comes to the acid, because it will start to affect your skin. You will feel it. The other thing is, these are spray bottles, and you are using them very close to your face. And I've used the acid, even though the acid is only vinegar, it still has a strong smell, but that stuff will get in. I mean, I've done a record cleaning session, and I've ended up with a nosebleed. What the hell? You know. So, yeah, wear something to cover your nose and mouth, because you're putting chemicals into the air. I know it may not seem like a lot of chemicals, but it's amazing what chemicals can do. And especially if you're using the vinegar, that's quite a lot of vinegar to end up getting into your getting into you. And particularly some of them are irritants. They're irritants. So if you get them in your eyes or something, you will cause yourself a problem. And it's worthwhile reading the data sheets. This is the data sheet for Dapon. This is the data sheet for Liquinox, which you can easily download these things. Also, this is the data sheet for Ilfotol. These used to run off the tongue when I was doing photography. This is another nasty one. This is the sheet for Citronox, because I do have, hopefully, some Citronox on the way. I may have just managed to order a quart of Citronox, before it's gone over to the gallon. So there's a few, we've got the finish here and another chemical to introduce you to, which is this one. This is BAC 50, benzochlonium chloride. You'll notice not only still in the bottle, but I haven't even opened the plastic thing that it came in, because this is one nasty chemical. Available on Amazon for 15 quid. What is the purpose of that chemical? It's basically what's known as a quat. Quat, I think. But the purpose of a quat is to leave some of itself behind on the record in order to provide antistatic qualities. I bought it because I thought I had a bit of an antistatic problem, but I didn't. Well, I did, but it wasn't that. So I bought that stuff and then realized that I'd wasted my money, pretty much. If you end up with a situation where you're really in a bind and you do need to leave something on the record, remember that the goal of this is to leave the record as clear as possible with nothing on it, and you have to use a quat, then be very careful. This will be going for chemical disposal, because I'm not going to use it. I'm perfectly happy with the results I've got. The BAC 50 does have a contraindication with Liquinox. Neil did paste the warning in bright lights. Make sure that all Liquinox is off the record before, and off the brush, whatever, before you use BAC 50. Otherwise, nasty things will happen. And indeed, reading the safety sheet for BAC 50, it's nasty. It is one hell of a nasty piece of kit. So, but you can get these things. Where is the BAC 50? Safety data sheet. Benzochondium chloride, or whatever the hell. This thing is serious. You can probably say that this goes beyond irritant. This is serious, serious stuff. You do not pour this stuff down the sink at any cost. But the key thing is, it is a quat, and the intention would be to put some of it in wash number three. Well, there's a couple of different ways of doing it. It's all in the blog. But the intention is to put it in number three in a high enough quantity that even though you do wash, some of it will be left behind on the record to provide antistatic qualities. If you get hold of your antistatic correctly, and you've got decent precautions in place, and you handle correctly, you've got good hygiene, I don't see the need to actually use something as nasty as that. But the option is there, the knowledge is there for you. Finally, when it comes to getting drying the record and getting things off, you need a sponge. This isn't any old sponge. It is a super absorbent PVA sponge, something or other. I've now got paperwork coming out the wahoosie, and this is a right mess. Don't worry, we're going to go through all this again in a minute. That's the BAC 50, that's the safety sheet, that's the basic process. And I now need the last couple of bits and pieces on the list, which is this. Yeah. Yeah. PVA water absorbing sponge. They can absorb a hell of a lot of water. These cost £24 for two to be delivered to the UK from America. I did eventually find the UK equivalent, which was something called Sponge, and they've made a play on the HO to make it H2O, and they cost about £4 each. I'm not too much of a fan of them. I don't know if you can see, but that's cut at a weird angle at the top there, and it doesn't sort of flow as easily as the one from America, but you can get hold of these for about £4 each. You should only need one, and they're in plastic bags for a reason. If you leave them totally dry out, they go a bit weird. They go very weird, and you can reactivate them by just wetting them again. So they're in plastic bags to stop them from drying out permanently. The next, we're nearly there, don't worry. The next is the microfiber cloth. These, tiger cloth. Where I got myself in a mess is I couldn't easily find these at a reasonable price. So I thought, I know, I'll get hold of Ilford anti-static cloth. Wrong! As Neil said, these are cotton with an anti-static coating. And they ended up responsible for an anti-static charge on the record after I was drying it. These are actually made with copper threads. You'll see plenty of people complain that the edges of this of these cloths are not finished properly. And as such, you've got to be a little bit watchful, because the unfinished edges can leave some lint behind. So be mindful for that. I've got the idea that if they finished the edges properly, then it would lose it, then they'd be interfering with the qualities of the cloth. But that's what I believe. And I eventually did find cheaper ways of getting these. And Wex Photo Video is where I got these from. £8 a piece, plus a few quid postage. So I've got a couple of these. They do not have anti-static properties. As in, they are inherently non-static, if you know what I mean. If you're thinking, oh, I know, I'll use one of those to wipe the static off my record before I play it. No, the static will be left behind, because it does not have any static properties, and that's why using one of these to dry the record works. Yeah. Last thing is a drying rack for the records. And I got this. It's a generic record drying rack from China. There are other people who are using these cost about 15 quid, and it took a while to get hold of one. There are people who are using standard dish drying racks. Nothing against that, but I was seeing some of them, whereas the bit that stands up and the record itself was leaning against them, not the label, the record. So I thought, so I decided to get myself a drying rack. So that's about it. The whole price for all of this, if you go for the basic options, comes in at less than £170. So, long story short, you need 4 bottles. You need to prepare the bottles as per the instructions in Neil's book. Bit of an arse, but it's not too bad. Provided you've got good quality running tap water, you should be good to go. Once the bottles are prepared, you mostly fill them with distilled water. Then you put in the requisite amount of chemicals that are needed, tiny amounts, using the pipettes. In the case of the acid, you probably will be using vinegar instead of distilled water, with just a little bit of the Dapon. So it's relatively straightforward to do that. You use the label to protect the record, and then you start going through the washes as needed. You use the brush, and you use it, you don't put pressure on it, you move it fast. And in moving it, that is what activates the chemicals for the chemicals to do their thing. You go through with tap water washes between each of the three. After you finish the third wash, you then want to displace the third wash. By the way, when you do this to wash the water off, you're washing the surfactant out. When you wash the surfactant out, the water will then bead up on the surface again. Then you can use the last spray gun, which is the distilled water, to knock off the tap water. That leaves you hopefully with a majority of distilled water there. So when the distilled water evaporates, there's nothing left behind. You take a good chunk of it off using the sponge. That will get a good chunk of the water off for you. Once that is off, you then finish off with the tiger cloth and then you carefully disassemble this. Once you've very carefully disassembled, you use the tiger cloth to clean up whatever is in it is left on the record, and that's it. It's the first time I recommend getting hold of a couple of second-hand records and practicing the wash with them. It is a bit of a faff to put everything together and to do it the first few times. Once you've done it, you'll get into the rhythm of doing it. Once you do that, you should be able to up the speed with which you're doing it. And I'm impressed. I am impressed with the results. Whether you then want to go for an ultrasonic clean on top of this, that's a decision that you have to make. I'm not sure myself how much benefit, extra benefit, the ultrasonic wash will give me. But I believe that the ultrasonic, once the key crud is off a record and I handle it properly, ultrasonic should do me and I should not need to deal with the chemicals so much. Key to making a decision as to which chemicals and how much faff you go to, how much expense, is probably going to be down to how many records you think you're going to clean and in what time scale. The core chemicals, if looked after, the concentrated chemicals rather, I should probably say, if looked after, should last about 6 years if you take care of them. Once they are in the bottles, in diluted form, again, if you take care of them, they should in theory last about 8 weeks. Then you will need to empty the bottles and refresh them. So, it's all going to be down to how many you're going to clean, how often, and just be aware that you can't make up these mixtures and then come back to them about 3 or 4 months down the line. You're going to have to refresh them at some point. So you may want to think about how big a bottle you're buying, because those ones are 700 and odd mil. These are about half the size. So, you know, once I've made these up, only to do a handful of records and then eventually throw them away, I'm not throwing away too much chemical. I'm not wasting too much. It's down to you. And that is basically how it hangs together. Protect your label, make up your chemical mixtures, do the wash, and then drying at the end. Personally, the results I'm getting are worth it. It's been worth the hassle for me. I've done about half of the records behind me and a few extra which are in a different cupboard. And I've been impressed. The ability to just take the record out of the sleeve, put it on the deck and just play the thing is impressive. And with the older records, because the instruments themselves are coming over very clear, the hisses, the clicks and pops in the background aren't so much of a bother because the music is standing out over them. I'm enjoying the process. I'm enjoying the results that I'm getting from this, and being able to do this and just be able to take a record out, pop it on, and bingo. It's pretty much the ultimate for me, because I am hearing about some people who are taking a record out, they're putting it in an ultrasonic cleaner for a 5 minute quick cycle before they even put it on the deck. I can understand why they're doing it, but hey ho. And that's roughly where it all comes together. So now we are going to go to an example of me cleaning one of the records, and I've just realised that if the record was genuinely the 1930s as I thought it would have been shellac, not vinyl. So of course it was actually a reissue. Duh. But yeah. Getting hold of things, making the decisions, Not the easiest thing, but for me, it's been worthwhile. And yeah, I hope this helps. Hope this helps you make some decisions. And the other thing is that chemicals change. You know, things get banned or other replacement chemicals come in. It's a moving thing. And indeed, I've got to see if I can get another one of these for 7-inch records. But that's proving now to be difficult to find. So, the blog post is there with a lot more details, including links to where I got various things and the costs of them, and a more detailed breakdown of the process. Some of which is actually Neil's words, because he went through the blog post and suggested some things, suggested some edits and some different wording to use, most of which I've done. A few things I wanted to make points. So yeah, not straightforward, but in my book, worthwhile. Yeah, now to go clean a record. Right, this is not the most appropriate sink at which to wash records, but for the sake of my purposes, it's the most appropriate sink to film washing records, if you know what I mean. Ideally, you'll be wanting something larger than this with more room to operate, something like a kitchen sink. Neil recommends putting something like a plastic bowl in, so if you drop the record, it's going to hit plastic, not anything hard. And also potentially put something around the tap itself in case you knock up against the tap. Something like a rubber hose outlet or something like that. Shouldn't have made that gesture, should I? No. But stuff it. This is probably the ideal kind of tap for this. I know that a bit over there, and I'm going to get the right temperature. I'm trying to mix temperatures with individual faucets, thus more inappropriate gestures, shouldn't do that. So this is possibly the best type of tap to use for this. We are going to, because the chances of me smashing a record in here are quite high, we're going to use an old one that I bought secondhand, the Great Radio Foods. W.C. Fields with Edgar Bergen, Charlie McCarthy and Don Ameche. This was from a mono recording from... oh, that's interesting. Design 1974. So this is... The 1930s will long be remembered. What the hay is going on here? I don't know. It looks like it may be a reissue in 1970s or something. Who knows? But... I'm not going to overly cry if I mess this record up. So, pretty much, we've got gloves, and I've also got, because we're using the acid on this one, because I thought it was an old one, older than I thought it was, I've also got a face mask on. Mono recording, this does look like it's 1970s, newer than I thought, but hey-ho. Obviously it's got a lot of crap on it. And who knew? So we're just going to put this in here. And obviously another thing, it's bad enough trying to wash a record in this kind of sink if you're just washing the record, but if you're filming as well and trying to talk your way through things, it gets even worse. I chose this of the various clamps because this is all rubber, as opposed to the ones who have the small rubber ring inside. Those are a real headache to handle. And also I've sort of got a knob one here and a handle one side. I sort of merged two of them together to get something that was a bit better for me. Now you'll notice the four wash bottles up here. We have the pre-clean acid, NID, and the DIW, the distilled water. One brush pretty much does the whole thing, and although I've got this sort of plectrum here to potentially break the seal if it doesn't go, with this type I haven't had to yet, but instead it's come in handy as a marker for which one of these I'm using next. Yeah, real mess. So we're going to start with this. This is going to be a bit colder, but what the hey. doesn't matter too much, and we're just going to brush this in, and you are going to see from the water surface tension at work, if you haven't already, if you're out of physics lessons for so long. So this is just a simple wash, get all the basics off it, you know. And you can probably see on there, I hope, that it hasn't really gone in. As you can see, we've got surface tension on there and the water hasn't really gone anywhere much. As you can possibly see on here, I hope that all the water is on the surface, not going anywhere. So first off, as Neil Anton said, these two washes do, and the first two, pretty much 90% plus of the hard work. So these are the two we're going to concentrate on. So we're going to put the pre-clean on first. I got about 6 squirts on that. And as Neil says, it's not pressure, it's action. I've forgotten the precise words he used, but we're going to do as much as we can here to agitation. That was the word, agitation. It's not pressure, it's agitation. I'm putting bugger all pressure on here. I'm going to get it one way around to get most of this in. As you can probably see, I hope, I can't totally see what you're seeing, but now we've got most of it in, we're just going to continue to agitate. And we're going to go like this for a few ways around. The more agitation, the better. Get those suds working. As Neil says, pretty much, it's the suds are what happens. Activate the chemicals and let the chemicals do the work. You don't have to put much in the way of pressure behind this. That's a bit bonkers, thinking that this record was older than it was, but hey-ho. Don't really know what to say while I'm doing this because I'm speaking and my glasses are now starting to fog up. This is pretty much what we're doing, getting the chemicals to do what they're supposed to be doing. So we'll typically run about 2 or 3 ways round this with good agitation, getting things rocking and rolling. Doing this at sort of an angle when the camera's there. The camera's where I usually stand, so I fully expect to smack this record against the sink or the tap. So really let it do its thing. And we do the same on the other side. And you can probably see how the water just goes in there now. Even just spraying it, you can see it's all going in as opposed to beading on the surface. So I'll pretty much do the same, get it agitating all the way around, and then tip it and get the surface water, get the excess water off. Right, so we can now tip it reasonably. Get agitating. I think I'm typically doing what Neil's doing as well, about 4 to 6 records in a session, because not only are you exposing yourself to a fair chunk of chemicals, but your arm aches. Whoops, and I've smacked the camera. You see, you're operating in a confined space here. As soon as you're sort of dribbling off. Now, one of the awkward things for someone like me is because I don't own very much in the way of microscopes. I can't actually tell very much about the state of the records before I'm doing them. So what I'm doing is more or less a matter of faith, rather than knowing exactly what I'm targeting here. So we're really putting some elbow grease into this, giving it good agitation and giving it the best chance we can give it. This being a mono recording and a modern-ish mono recording, I should actually get a decent signal out of this. So now we wash, and by using the brush we are washing both the brush and the record at the same time. This is not the ideal sink for this. And you'll probably see that as we brush out the pre-clean, surface tension will return. Can't see what you're seeing, unfortunately. Whoops. There we go, told you I'd smack something. So there we go. That's a good chunk of the pre-clean off. The brush has also been cleaned. And that's that. Now, as Neil says, if it's a generally clean record, you'll just do one pre-clean, nid and distilled water. If it's dirtier or older, he'll give it a pre-clean, acid, nid and distilled. And if it's excessively dirty, he'll give it two pre-cleans, one acid, nid and distilled water. So now we've done that, so now we're just going to move on to the acid wash, which in our case is the vinegar wash, because we haven't got the Citronox. So we're just going to do the same thing here. Just give it a quick once round to get most of the water out, then tip it up a bit to get rid of the excess, to let the excess fall off rather, and then get busy with the agitation. Again, no pressure, letting the stiff brushes do what they're going to do. Give it good agitation. One of the things that Neil did also say is that the acid wash, if you're making it a vinegar, won't sud up the same way that the pre-clean will. Now, because we're using an aerosol with the vinegar or with the acid, that's the principal reason for wearing the mask, because all these are aerosols and they're putting some pretty nasty chemicals, especially in the case of the acid wash, right into the air. So the last thing you want to do is be breathing that. I've just noticed that the window's closed. Damn it. It doesn't smell too bad, to be honest. It just smells like someone's popped open a fresh bag of salt and vinegar crisps under your nose. But I then end up with after doing a session of about 9 or 10 records, the following day I ended up with a nosebleed, which is a bit uncharacteristic for me. So I assumed, time to wear a face mask, I think, when using the acids. So there we go. Now we do the acid on this side. How's the battery doing? All right. Again, a quick round to get most of it in, and then we can let the excess drip off, as it will. So that's most of it. So yeah, now agitate and let the chemicals do their thing. Good agitation, about 2 or 3 revolutions. When you think that the long cycle on something like the degritter 2 is about 11 minutes, this isn't too bad. It's just that you're having to do it manually as opposed to letting a machine do it for you. And personally, when it comes to some of these records, I would rather, the more you can get off with a manual clean, the better it's going to be for the degritter. The degritter isn't going to have to work too hard, and you're not going to wind up with so much crap in the tank, because you'd have taken off an awful lot here. So that's that one. We've just done the acid wash. Next one's going to be the nid. I should have moved that across. Because when you're actually doing a number of records and you do record and you're doing a session of about 4 to 6 records, it's dead easy to lose track of where your next wash is going to be. So it makes sense, pretty much. I'm recording this at a different time to the main video, so I've got no idea what I've already said. But I've had new records come in. Whoops. I've had new records come in at such a state on them that they've needed cleaning before I even put them on the turntable. You know, they've come out dirty out of the packet, out of the sleeve for the initial time after buying them brand new. So even new records get a clean in this house. Obviously, no need for the acid. But that's that one. Now we're on to the nid clean. Same thing again. Good agitation for at least about three turns, you know. First turn, you know, well, first all, you can do whatever you like, whatever you think's more appropriate. The trick is, after listening to the record, you may think still needs another clean and give it another clean. I mean, personally, what I'm going to do myself is save up for a degritter, and I'm going to use this method in combination with a degritter so that the degritter hasn't got to work so hard and the degritter can get stuff that I can't see and may not come loose with this method. I don't view this manual method as in competition with the degritter. I view it more in harmony with, as well as. Having said that, you can get some quite nice results with just this technique. So you may choose to just leave with this rather than save up for something as expensive as a degritter. You could also decide to go the cheap way for a sort of a jewellery tank ultrasonic. There's nothing wrong with that. It's just that I haven't got the space to handle the tank and the necessary runoff when you have to empty the tank through the tap. That's not very funny. There's a lot of people using the jewellery tank ultrasonics very well. They're making very good use of them. It's just for the, and even with something which is as compact as the degritter 2, I'm going to have problems finding space for it. And the fact that it's got its own tanks and filter, which makes the liquids easier to handle, you know, I'm all in favour of that. So here we are with this one. Again, get it agitated, get it working. How are we for battery? We're still fine. There we go. Now we're going to give this its last wash and clean the brush at the same time. We want to get a fair chunk out of this, as you'll see in a minute. Didn't realise this was a reissue. So I should get some quite good signal off this. W.C. Fields was, well, all of them were pretty much the famous comedians of their day. Some of the humour obviously doesn't hold up anymore, but hey-ho. So there we are. I am now, because the acid is finished, I'm just going to take this face mask off so I can see my glasses and I can see what's going on here. And I can hopefully see what you're seeing. Right, as you can see, the water here is beading up a fair chunk. And now we're going to use the distilled water. The purpose of this spray, and you're going to go through a fair chunk of this stuff, is to actually displace the tap water. So we're going to start from the top, work down. And as you will see, as this displaces the tap water, and also displaces whatever is left of the whatever is left of the surfactant, you can see there's all beating up there. It's all beating up quite a chunk. Can't see what the heck's going on with the light, but hopefully you can see an awful lot of beaded water on there. I'm trying to twist the record and look backwards at the camera display. Not easy, but hopefully you should see that everything's beaded up quite nicely on there. And we're going to do the same on the other side. Incidentally, I've probably said this already, but if you've got some old distilled water running around from a couple of years ago, you can use that for the distilled water spray. But when it comes to making these mixtures, I'd say use reasonably new distilled water. Now, we've got the sponge, and we are going to use this to wipe off the excess water. Because of its construction, it's not going to mess around with grooves. It's just going to take off the surface stuff quite well without too much grief. I'm just going to wipe in here as well to save us some trouble. You can still notice that's a bit damp. Just going to do the other side as well. Da 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 da. That's actually going quite well, quite nicely. We've got a fair chunk of the water off there. Now, last step. Just looking at a few bits, there's still some water there. Last is the tiger cloth. Now, I'll probably mention this already about the tiger cloth, but it does not have any static properties. So it doesn't collect static, it can't take static off a record, but by the same token, it can't leave static behind on a record because it's got no static property of its own. And it's probably the construction that's responsible for that, which means that it doesn't have very good edges. So I'm just going to do that and that. And that should take most of it off. It's probably because of the construction of this. I think Neil said that it was actually made with copper threads and the rest of it, which is probably why the edges are not finished. Because if the edges were finished, what material would they use to finish the edges with? And that would probably muck up the anti-static properties. So that's that for a minute. Now we're going to disassemble this. Be very careful in disassembling this. I've just gone down on the battery, so Oh, the pressures of filming. If you muck this up, you've got the potential that you could drop something and scratch the record. So be careful. I'm just going to break that and take that off. Being very careful not to drop it. All right, that's out. Now lift this off. Hopefully it should come off nice and cleanly. I'm having good results with this. With the other one, which was a ring based, I wasn't, it was sticking. And now we just go over the ring in the middle to clean up all the rest of the water. I'm just going to give a look across to make sure that none of the extra stuff from here has stuck to the surface. It hasn't, we're clean. So now we can turn it over, remove this, and do the same here. Whoops, knock at the microphone. I have to remember that in the edit. And there you go, nice, reasonably clean record. This now has to go to dry. And drying time will vary according to your temperature and your humidity. So this could be anything. I think at the moment, given today and all the rest of that jazz, I'm going to give this about half an hour to 40 minutes. There's an easy way to test. If you dry a record, let it dry, then put it straight on the turntable and you hear a faint background crackling, and then you play the record again and the crackling has gone, then that probably means that you didn't give it enough drying time. So that can be one method of finding out how much time you need to give it in your own temperature and humidity, wherever you are in the world. Neil does warn against over drying, because then it can then regenerate static with airflow and attract more dust and that crap like that. So yeah, this is now going to go into the rack. Unfortunately, the rack is the other side of the tripod, so I'm going to have to quit filming and put this one to dry, and I'm going to have to see what it's like in a bit. So that's an overview of the process. We have taken a fair chunk than usual here because I've been quite slow and thorough in doing this. If you're not using the acid, obviously you're going to save time if you're only doing new records. Give this a reasonable amount of time for the process. Give it a reasonable amount of time. Get some good action in there, and hopefully it should come up brilliantly for you. And I shouldn't be standing here holding the record talking to you like this. Good record hygiene is what will keep these records in good nick once you've done them. And with a number of these records, I'm just able to take them out of the antistatic HDPE sleeve, put them straight on the deck and play them. I don't even have to use the antistatic brush on them. That's one of the beauties of this. So you take it easy and I'll catch you later. Ciao for now.